I will tell of your name to my brothers. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you offspring of Jacob, glorify him and stand in awe of him, all you offspring of Israel. For he has not despised or abhorred the affliction of the afflicted. He has not hidden his face from him, but has heard when he cried to him. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will perform before those who fear him. The afflicted shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. Father, thank you for your presence in this place. We certainly do not deserve you to be here with us, but it's because your mercy and grace is so great. You still love us in spite of our sin, in spite of our shortcomings, in spite of our iniquity. So we pray that everything that we do and say this morning would bring honor and glory to your name, because you are worthy of all our praise and all our adoration. We thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, whom you sent to take your wrath upon your Son so that we wouldn't have to. Bless our time together this morning, O Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's worship our Lord together in song.
Sorrows, Lamb of God, and by his own betrayed, the sin of man and the wrath of God has been on Jesus laid. And silent as he stood up, and scorn, and bowing to the Father's will, he took a crown of thorns. And oh, that rugged cross, my salvation. stone is rolled away. Behold the empty tomb.
Now my soul cries out. never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will see the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able,
seated. Thank you, guys, for leading us in that time of worship, praise, and song. Let's look to the Lord in prayer as we continue to worship our great God. Father, I suppose the question that begs to be answered this morning is, are we truly running into your arms? Or are we chasing after the world and all its enticements? I think if we're honest with ourselves and with you this morning, we would say that we have done some of each this past week. Perhaps more running to the world than others, and vice versa. Father, I pray that you would help us to always run away from the world and run towards you. Help us to constantly seek your face and seek you and who you are, because you are so worthy. There is none like you. There is no other embrace that we should look forward to than the one that comes from you. And we pray that you would help us this morning. For as we read your word and we sing your praises, as we hear your word proclaimed this morning, we can feel your warm embrace as you teach us to be more like Christ. Help us, O Lord. Help us. We think this morning of Norma Acevedo. We pray your blessings upon her. Father, we do rejoice that her work schedule has changed, and we're praying that she'll be able to now join us more often. Help her, Lord, to walk closely with you. Use her in her place of employment and touch her life and her health. And maybe you be clearly at work in her life and heart. We pray for Philip and Sarah Wetzel. We're thankful for them becoming parents again, having this privilege, this opportunity. And we ask for a safe delivery of this little one. Father, we pray that you would bless Philip and Sarah as they raise all three of their children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. And we pray that each one would come to a saving knowledge of you, Lord Jesus. We're thankful for this couple's involvement here at this church. May they continue to serve you well in this place. Father, we think of our Bible Adventure Week quickly coming towards us, quickly approaching. And we pray that you would, we still need a skit person, so we pray that you would provide that individual. We're thankful for the work that's already been laid out and done in preparation for that week. And Father, we pray that you would bring the children, bring them out to hear the gospel, bring them out to sing, to play games, bring them out to hear about Jesus. And we pray that you would use the staff that has been assembled to faithfully proclaim the gospel of Christ. Pray for the workday. Pray for the Bright Hope Walk for Life. We ask that you would meet each of those needs. We pray that those would be good events. We think of WJCS Radio. We ask your blessing upon this ministry. Use them as they spread the gospel. Father, we pray for peace and the spread of the gospel in Ukraine and in Russia and in Turkey and in Syria and in Iraq and Iran, in Israel, Saudi Arabia. We could go on and on. We think of Senegal, where Bo and Michelle Columbine serve, in Turkey, where the Lachelles are, in Kenya, where the Thompsons serve, and in Japan, where the Roses are. And we could go on and on with that too, Lord You know the needs, and you know the things that each one of these families need, these servants of yours. Bless them and use them, and may they see revival come in their land. May revival come to our land, for that is our hope. Our hope is not in the next president. Our hope is not in a strong military. Our hope is not even in a strong dollar, but it's in a strong Savior. And we praise you for that, and we pray that you would cause us to understand that, and may our hearts and minds go to you and trust you, O Lord Almighty God. And then finally, we think about our own families. We all have those loved ones that are outside of Christ. May they come to a saving knowledge of you, Lord Jesus. I think also of the Treese family as they are going through this time of bereavement. And we ask that you would move in that family's life, perhaps using Joe and Carol to share Christ with their loved ones, their family members, their friends. We ask for your help and support for our pastor this morning as he opens the bread of life and he teaches us. May our hearts be attuned and open to hear from your servant that which you have given him throughout this week. Use him in our hearts and our lives so that we could be more like Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Turn in your Bibles, please, to Isaiah chapter 55. Isaiah chapter 55. And we will start reading at verse 6 and read through verse 11. This is the word of God. Isaiah 55, verse 6. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, that he may have compassion on him and our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts. Neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven, and do not return there but water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth, it shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose, and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of the Lord stands forever. Please stand with me as we continue to sing Great Truths of God's Faithfulness, Great Truths of Our Great God. Hymn number 25. Thank you.
How is your hearing this morning? How's your hearing? In many ways, I'm looking forward to one aspect of getting old, and that is I'm hoping that my hearing starts to slowly diminish. Because as it is now, there's a lot of things that I hear that I don't want to hear. Emily and I have a regular conversation in the car, which goes something like, me, do you hear that? Because I hear something rattling, something squeaking. It's in the glove box. It's in the door compartment. It's in the back. Of course, we can't reach it. And of course, and Emily says, what? If you hadn't said that, I would have never heard anything. But for some reason, those things drive me crazy. So I'm kind of looking forward to like the time when maybe my hearing just starts to go a little bit. And then all the squeaks, all the rattles, I'll just never hear. I ask this today because our text is about hearing. We're back in the Gospel of Mark after taking a break to look at the resurrection of Christ. We're in the Gospel of Mark. We're in chapter 4, beginning in verse 21, and our text is about hearing. And I admit, as I was planning the Gospel of Mark and looking forward, I was originally kind of unsure where to put these verses. In some ways, you could put these verses with the parable of the soils that we dealt with 2 weeks ago, last time we were in Mark. They kind of go with that. Many commentators and pastors that I looked to see what they did lump these verses in with the ones that follow. We're going to see the parables, two more parables about seeds later on, and many kind of put these verses with those that follow. But the more I looked at these, the more I became convinced that these really deserve their own treatment. These deserve their own treatment. I'm going to read them in just a minute. But before I do want to draw your attention to the structure of these verses, verses 21 to 25, which I have here on the back of your bulletin. On the back of your bulletin, you'll see that there are two main sections to our text. Verses 21 through 23 is the first main section, and then verses 24 and 25 is the second main section. And what I want you to notice is the parallelism between these sections. Each one begins with a metaphor, followed by an enigmatic explanation, and then central to this passage, ending the first section, beginning the second, are calls to hear, commands to pay attention. So that's central to our text, and these are two kind of metaphors and enigmatic explanations, and right in the middle is the call to hear, the call to pay attention. So let me read our text, Mark chapter 4, beginning in verse 21. This is Jesus speaking. And he said to them, is a lamp brought in to be put under a basket or under a bed and not on a stand? For nothing is hidden except to be made manifest, nor is anything secret except to come to light. If anyone has ears to hear, let him hear. And he said to them, pay attention to what you hear. With the measure you use, it will be measured to you, and still more will be added to you. For to the one who has, more will be given, and from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. This is God's word. Let's ask his help as we open it up this morning. Our Father, we are gathered here to meet with you this morning, knowing that we can only come and offer our praises and our prayers and hear your word because you have purchased us by the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. You have made us your children by his work, his life, death, and resurrection. And so we come to you through him, asking that he would pour out his spirit upon us this morning, that we would be able to see and understand the truth of your word and apply it to our lives. Do that work among us. Conform us to his image. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our great God and Savior. Amen. So as we jump into our text this morning, it's been a week since we've been in Mark. So again, I want to set the scene for this text by reminding us a little bit about the setting of this text. So I'm going to give us two things about the setting as we jump in. And the first thing that we need to think about is, who is Jesus talking to when he is saying these verses? When he is speaking these words, who is he talking to? Because in chapter 4 of the Gospel of Mark, we have two different times taking place, and Mark kind of moves between one and the other. In the opening of chapter 4, we see that Mark begins by Jesus being out on a boat, and he's speaking to the crowds, and he delivers the parable of the soil. But then, as we saw 2 weeks ago, Mark jumps forward in time in verse 10 to a time when Jesus later on was just with his followers, the 12 disciples and a few others, and he was speaking just to them, where he kind of interpreted the parable of the soils and told them about the reason why he spoke in parables. And we know that by the end of the gospel, by the end of chapter four, he'll be back in the boat out with the crowds. But it's a little bit ambiguous as to when Mark shifts back to that perspective. What I'd like to argue is that Mark shifts back after this text. That this text should really be taken with what precedes it, and Jesus speaking not to the crowds, but to his disciples. And one reason I think that is because if you look at our text in verse 21 and in verse 24, it says, it opens up Jesus' words by saying, "And he said to them." And he said to them. But in verse 26, which we'll get to after this text, it says just the generic, "And he said." And he said. So I think that the best way to take these verses is that Jesus is speaking them to his disciples, and that means they should be taken in the context of the parable of the soils. That Jesus has just told them the parable of the soils and interpreted it to his disciples, to his core followers, and then gives this immediately after his interpretation of that parable. So we should take these in conjunction with what we looked at 2 weeks ago about the purpose of parables and this parable of the soils. And what we're going to see is that what Jesus is really doing here is giving these instructions to prevent his disciples from drawing a misapplication from what he's just said. We'll get to that more as we walk through the text. The second thing I want us to look at to notice is to orient our view of this text is that in these few verses, Jesus uses a lot of different sayings. He talks about a lamp being set to shine. He talks about measuring. He talks about all these different things. And if you read the rest of the Gospels, what you'll notice is that these are familiar sayings for Jesus. This isn't the only time that Jesus used these sayings. In fact, he uses them in different contexts and different places throughout the Gospels. For example, the Gospel of Luke records Jesus' use of the metaphor of the lamp being set on a stand to give light to the room in two different times at two different contexts. Both Matthew and Luke record two different occurrences of the final saying as well, about to the one who has, more will be given. The one who has not, even what he has will be taken away from them. The point is that these sayings seem to be ones that Jesus routinely used, but sometimes in different contexts, and therefore have a kind of different slant on them. So they're probably familiar to us, but we need to be careful that we don't run to another passage with a different context and kind of import that meaning here. For example, we shouldn't run to Matthew when Jesus speaks to his disciples, use the metaphor of the lamp set on a stand, and says to his disciples, "You are the light of the world." We shouldn't run to that and then say, "Oh, well, that must be what's going on here in Mark," because in Mark, Jesus is actually doing something a little bit different. We need to pay attention to the particular context of the Gospel of Mark here to understand what Jesus means. So those are our two kind of setting points, orienting us towards the text. Jesus is speaking to his disciples in the context of his revealing of the purpose of parables. And he's speaking these things that are common saying, but they have a particular meaning because of their particular context. So let's jump in and look at verses 21 through 23. I'm going to read these again. They're short to get them fresh in our minds. "And he said to them, 'Is a lamp brought in to be put under a basket or under a bed and not on a stand? For nothing is hidden except to be made manifest, nor is anything secret except to come to light. If anyone has ears to hear, let him hear.'" This is a first metaphor that Jesus uses, and it has to do with a lamp. In the ancient world, the lamp that Jesus was talking about would have been essentially a clay bowl, that as it was formed, the clay was pinched into a couple spouts along the edge, and it was filled with oil. You could have put a little piece of cloth through the spouts, soaked them in oil, and as you lit them, they would have soaked up the oil from the bowl and produced light and given light to the room. Most houses in the ancient world probably only had one, maybe two rooms, unless you were very wealthy, and so one lamp would have given light pretty much to the entire room. That's what Jesus is talking about. It's a very common illustration from household life. The basket that Jesus talks here about putting over the lamp is a common measuring basket used to measure dry goods. It would have held about 2 gallons. And the bed was a low couch used for dining or resting, either one. And so that's what Jesus is talking about, common everyday items. And at one level, like the level that's kind of not very significant, the metaphor is clear. Like, of course, Jesus is saying, yes, lamps are meant to give light. You don't light a lamp and then stick it under a basket or your couch, and because then it wouldn't give light to anywhere. Not to mention, Jesus doesn't mention, but it maybe it'll light that on fire. You know, you don't want that. But once you start to ask, well, what is the spiritual truth that this is intended to convey? It gets a little harder to discern. This is an enigmatic saying. And it's not really helped by the explanation. Verse 22 is an explanation of this saying, but let me just read verse 22 and see if that helps and makes it crystal clear. He says this, "For nothing is hidden except to be made manifest, nor is anything secret except to come to light." This doesn't really seem to explain very much at all. After all, in the beginning, Jesus said, well, you don't light a lamp to hide it. And yet in the explanation, Jesus talks about things being hidden and secret in order to be made manifest. In other words, they are actually actively hidden so that they could come to light, which he just said you kind of don't do with the lamp. So there's a lot going on, and it seems that this is just confusing. So what can we do with this? Well, a few points help us out. Let me draw your attention to a few things that will clue us into what Jesus is doing here. The first is something that, regrettably, it's very hard to see in your English translations. I looked at just about every English translation I could get my hands on, and almost everyone begins the same way. It begins with Jesus' words saying, "Is a lamp brought? Is a lamp brought?" And that's not really what Jesus says. In fact, though every translation says, "Is a lamp brought?" every commentator will note that actually what Jesus says is not, "Is a lamp brought?" but, "Does a lamp come? Does a lamp come?" In other words, when Jesus is making the lamp the subject of the verb, the lamp is doing the acting and the coming. Most of our translations talk about the lamp being the object of the verb, the lamp being brought. Now, at one level, I can understand why our translators do this, because when is the last time any of us saw a lamp do anything other than sit and maybe shine? Like, lamps don't walk. Maybe they fall over if you have kids in your house and knock them over, but lamps don't generally come into a room. And so it just seems odd that Jesus would say that, and so I can understand why our translators kind of try to make sense out of this. But I think we should pay attention to what Jesus does say, because what he's doing is he's speaking of the lamp as an active agent. In other words, he's personalizing it. It is doing something. That's the first thing we should notice. And then the second thing we should notice to help us understand what Jesus is doing here is that this is said immediately after Jesus has just explained to his disciples why he spoke in parables. And remember what he said to them back in verse 10. Verse 11 of chapter 4, he says this to his disciples, "To you has been given the secret of the kingdom of God, but for those outside, everything is in parables." And so if you've just heard that statement, "To you has been given the secret of the kingdom of God, but to everyone else, to those outside, everything is in parables." If you've just heard that statement, when you then hear Jesus speaking about something being hidden to made manifest and secret to be disclosed later, you're supposed to tie those two together. I think his disciples are supposed to hear that and say, oh, he's going back to what he just said about the secret of the kingdom of God. And when we put those two things together, everything seems to click into place. And what I believe Jesus is doing here is speaking of himself as the lamp, bringing the kingdom of God, the light of the gospel that is meant to shine. And what he's doing is correcting a misapplication that his disciples could have drawn from what he had just said about the secret of the kingdom. You see, you could see his disciples. I think it's not out of the realm of possibility to imagine his disciples hearing Jesus saying, "To you has been given the secret of the kingdom of God, but to everyone else, everything is in parables. You could imagine them hearing that and thinking, well, okay, I guess that this is just a message for us. And this is just for us. We got to be tight-lipped about this. It's really only for the special few. And then you could imagine them wanting to kind of construct a secret religion, a secret Christianity where only a few, only the initiates really know the message, really know the secret teachings and rites. But Jesus is correcting that. And what Jesus is saying is that though he has come in a veiled mode, speaking in parables to outsiders, though he has come hidden in a sense, the purpose of that hiddenness is not to remain, but so that it might become to light, so that the kingdom of God and the message might be brought to light. That is what I think the explanation means. When Jesus talks about something being hidden in order to be made manifest, that is what he's talking about. There was a real hiddenness that did characterize Jesus' ministry. I mean, we've seen this through the Gospel of Mark. What has Jesus done a couple different times in the Gospel of Mark to people he's healed and to demon-possessed people? What has he said to them? He said, don't tell anyone who I am. Don't go out and say who I am. There was a kind of hiddenness to Jesus' ministry, but it wasn't intended to be a permanent characteristic of Christianity. It was purposeful, hidden for a time so that Jesus could accomplish the mission for which he came. Paul actually makes this point explicit in 1 Corinthians 2, verses 7 to 8. In those verses, Paul says that if the rulers of this age who did not understand the mystery of the gospel, he says they did not understand the mystery of the gospel because if they did, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. They wouldn't have crucified Christ. And so there is a hiddenness to the gospel during Jesus' earthly ministry, hiddenness to his mission and to his identity. It's mysterious, so that he can accomplish the mission for which he came. Let me give you an illustration. It's almost like Jesus is on a special operation, an undercover operation in enemy territory. And when you're on an undercover operation in enemy territory, you don't announce your identity and mission to all your enemies. No, there is a necessary layer of secrecy involved so that once the operation is finished and the mortal blow is delivered to the enemy, then it can be made public and be brought to light. That's what Jesus is saying here. He's saying that though he came in a veiled manner and spoke in parables, concealing things to outsiders, it was for a purpose so that he might accomplish his mission. And therefore, post-resurrection, after Jesus has delivered the mortal blow and been victorious, post-resurrection, what does Jesus tell his disciples to do? To go into all the nations, proclaiming the gospel. It was hidden in order to be made manifest, in order to come to light. Before we move on to the next section, I do want to draw a word of application from this. True Christianity is not a secretive religion. We don't have a secret message only to be given to a special few. True Christianity is an open religion. The church publicly proclaims what we believe for all to see. I mean, there's no secret what Christianity teaches. From the very beginning, it publicly published these creeds and confessions stating, this is what we believe. We translate the scriptures into as many human languages as possible. And this is a crucial aspect. And it's a distinguishing mark between true Christianity and the cults. Many cults, in fact, almost all cults, are secretive about what they believe, secretive about rites and rituals that they have and who they really let in. And they often try to hide their beliefs from the outsiders, at least until a point as someone becomes so entangled that it'd be very difficult for them to get out. But that is not how we are to operate. Pseudo-Christian cults say, yeah, we believe in God, we believe in Jesus, but what they don't tell you is they've redefined God and they've redefined Jesus to mean something totally different. Church, we can have no part in this secrecy. The Christian message is an open message. It has been revealed for all to see. That's why we welcome unbelievers into our worship services. The worship service is not designed for unbelievers. It is designed for God's people to worship him, and yet we welcome them to come. We are not doing anything here that is not for them to know about, not for them to see. No, we welcome them to come to observe everything that we do, to hear everything that we do. Even when we celebrate the ordinances, baptism and the Lord's Supper, though those are not for them, and we don't admit them to baptism, we don't baptize unbelievers, and we don't admit them to participate in the Lord's Supper, that is for believers, they are free to observe. It's not like we're hiding anything from them. So, church, we should not conceal or think that this is a message only for a special few, only for us. No, we welcome others. We welcome them into our lives, into our church services to see. We proclaim an open message. And it also means, church, that Christians should not be part of organizations that engage in this kind of secrecy. We should not be part of organizations that force us to hide what we really think and what we really believe. No, the gospel is a gospel of light and is one that we cannot hold in good conscience if we are engaging in secretive practices. And that brings us to the second point, to the second section of this text in verses 24 and 25, which I've entitled Give and Take. And if this first section was about the revealing of the kingdom of God in the person of Jesus, the second section is all about our response. This is what Jesus says in verse 24 through 25. He says this, "Pay attention to what you hear. With the measure you use, it will be measured to you, and still more will be added to you. For to the one who has, more will be given, and from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away." And this metaphor, like the first one, at first glance is rather enigmatic and hard to explain. But when we understand this teaching in the context of Jesus' teaching on parables and the parable of the soil, well, and the command to pay attention, I think the meaning becomes clear. The measuring that Jesus is talking about here is a metaphor for hearing and understanding his words. He's instructing his followers on the principle of spiritual attentiveness, saying to the one who actively seeks understanding, more will be given. But to the one who doesn't pay attention to even what little he has, that will be taken from him. Essentially, Jesus is saying, with regard to the kingdom of God and spiritual understanding, you get out of it what you put into it. Now, I don't want us to misunderstand Jesus. I don't want us to misunderstand him, because he's not saying that when it comes to salvation, your part contributes anything to it. He's not saying that, well, when it comes to salvation, you have to do your part and contribute to your own salvation. No, he's not contradicting what Scripture says elsewhere, that we are saved by grace through faith alone, apart from ourselves. What he's saying is, when it comes to spiritual understanding, there is no standing still. You will either be progressing and seeking God and being given more and more, or you will be given less and less, and even what you have will be taken away from you. The great Anglican preacher J.C. Ryle put it like this. He said this, "Attention to this great principle is the main secret of spiritual prosperity. The man who makes rapid progress in spiritual attainments, who grows visibly in grace and knowledge and strength and usefulness, will always be found to be a diligent man. He leaves no stone unturned to promote his soul's well-doing. He's diligent over his Bible, diligent in his private devotions, diligent as a hearer of sermons, diligent in his attendance at the Lord's table. And he reaps according as he sows. Just as the muscles of the body are strengthened by regular exercise, so are the graces of the soul increased by diligence in using them." The principle of Proverbs 19:15 is true here, spiritually as well as physically. It says this, "An idle person will suffer hunger. An idle person spiritually will suffer spiritual hunger." So, church, let me ask you a few things. What is your Bible engagement like according to this principle of spiritual attentiveness, which J.C. Ryle calls the main secret of spiritual prosperity? I submit to you that if your Bible engagement looks like reading the verse of the day from your favorite Instagram Christian influencer or something like that, and does not involve sustained, careful, reflective, prayerful Bible study, then you should not be surprised when anytime you open up the Bible, you're just confused about what it says. You shouldn't be surprised. Similarly, if your cultural engagement is really just shaped by the 24-hour news cycle and social media, and you can't remember the time you ever read a single book on Christian theology and to grasp the scope of what Christianity teaches, well, you shouldn't be surprised when you're at a loss to how to respond to the cultural topics and how to think biblically and critically about them. If your prayer life consists of a 10-second, God is great, God is good, let us thank him for this food before dinner, and nothing else, that's a fine prayer to pray. But if that is the bread and butter of your prayer life and nothing else, well, you shouldn't be surprised if you feel distant from God and you don't feel close communion with him. And lastly, if you're up to date on all your TV shows and all your sports teams, but your church commitment looks like, well, you attend once or twice a month, as long as it's convenient, as long as you're not too tired, as long as you don't have anything else going on, and God forbid you ever stay for Sunday school or make it to Wednesday night, if that is what your commitment to the body of Christ looks like, well, you should not be shocked if you don't feel connected and you don't feel a sense of Christian fellowship. In other words, if the measure that is appropriate to use for your earnest seeking after God and the means of grace, if it's a teaspoon, you can expect teaspoon results. This text is an admonition and a warning to us to seek God diligently, to pay attention to what we hear. To the one who has, more will be given. From the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. If anyone has ears, let him hear. Pay attention to what you hear. But it's not only an admonition. So far, we've kind of focused on that last pit, you know, to the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. But it's also an encouragement and a promise. This text promises us, to the one who has, more will be given. That is a promise from Christ for his people. In other words, the words of Hebrews 11:6 apply this: God rewards those who seek him. This text is a promise of reward for God for those who seek him, who diligently, day after day, come to him in prayer, open the word to hear what it says, and seek after him diligently, who meditate on his word, memorize it, who make Christian fellowship and worship a priority in their lives. God promises reward. He promises that for those who seek him, they will not return empty. He will answer them. To the one who has, more will be given. And that is why, in the very middle of this text, we see those calls to pay attention, to hear, to seek God. And it doesn't mean it'll be easy. J.C. Ryle rightly compares this to physical exercise. And I can tell you one thing, you don't become an Olympic athlete after exercising on the very first day of your training. That doesn't happen. But you know what does happen? You are on the path of health by that first step. Similarly, you are on the path of seeking God. It doesn't mean that the very first time you sit down to pray in a way that you haven't for a long time, it doesn't mean it's going to come easily and you're going to be immediately rewarded with being like on a mountaintop experience of communion with God. But it does mean that God will reward when you seek him. And he will progress you down that path. And the more and more you press in, the more and more of him you will see and experience and enjoy. I'd like us to remember as we close this morning that what Christ is calling us to is not to seek and pursue something that is dry and something that really is kind of boring and dead. No, he is calling us and telling us to seek after God himself. To seek after God himself, the source of all joy. He is reminding us to pay attention to what we hear and what we hear each and every week here. And as we open our Bibles, really the big story of the Bible is not about us, but it's about what God has done for us. It's about the gospel. It's about Christ and his work for his people. That is what he's calling us to seek and press into and go deeper and deeper in. He's calling us to joy and happiness and contentment and fulfillment. Psalm 37:4 puts it like this: delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Why? Because your desires will be for what you delight in. He will reward you with more of himself. Our call to worship says, those who seek him shall praise the Lord. Those who seek God will praise him, which is a reward in and of itself. And so as we close this morning, I'd just like to encourage you that Christ is calling us to joy, and he is promising us that for those who diligently seek him, who open their ears to pay attention to his word and to follow him carefully, he will reward with more and more knowledge of him, enjoyment of him, experience and communion with him. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we desire to press in after you. I pray that we would be a people whose lives are characterized by earnest, zealous seeking after you, that we would pursue likeness to Christ, that we would pursue holiness, pursue your word, pursue fellowship with one another, that we would leave no stone unturned in our search to know you more and enjoy you more, that we would make spiritual growth the primary concern of our lives. Lord, we thank you for the promise that you have given us, that to those who have more will be given, that you will reward such earnest seeking, that you will not turn a deaf ear and a blind eye to those who are going after you and seeking to know you. And so I pray that you would reward us, bless us, give us more and more knowledge of you, enjoyment of you, communion with you. That is our heart's desire. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Please stand as we respond to God's word by singing our second hymn. Which hymn is it? I don't have it. Hymn number 379, Take My Life and Let It Be.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee, swift and beautiful for thee. My voice and let me sing always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from thee, filled with messages from thee. Take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as thou shalt choose, every power as thou shalt choose. Take my will and make it thine, it shall be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is thine own, it shall be thy royal throne, it shall be thy royal throne. Take my love, my Lord, I pour, at thy feet its treasure store. Take myself and I will be ever only all for thee, ever only all for thee.
Church, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.